I'll ask you to start the session, and you can have few more sessions also to finish Indian Evidence Act. So you can try to finish as much as possible today, sir. You can even have a Q&A session if possible. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much for this opportunity that's been granted. I'm so grateful to you. Good morning to all one and all who are present here. In the last session, we have covered up to section 26. I hope so. And 26, I said that 26 has to be read along with the section 164 of the Criminal Procedure Code. 164 of the Criminal Procedure Code prescribes the procedure to be adopted by the learned magistrate who is recording the dying declaration. That is a confession of the accused. The confession of the accused is recorded as per the Evidence Act. Whenever the accused is in the police custody, it has to be recorded in the immediate presence of the magistrate. This is what the section 26 stimulates. So we'll have to start from again 24, recollect what I have said in the 24 and 25 and 26. And if you correlate all these things, 24, if you take the 24, 24 says that any confession which is given under the threat, promise or inducement is irrelevant, cannot be admitted as evidence at all, cannot be admitted in the court at all. So already I said the fundamental that in order to admit an evidence, it should fall under the ambit of section 5 of the Evidence Act. That is, either it should be a fact in issue or it should be a relevant fact, either of this, except these two things. If it comes under these two things, it cannot be admitted. So therefore, if you compare this section 5 with the section 24 of the Evidence Act, the 24 speaks about the confession. The confession, the what, by means of which they say confession should be free from any sort of influence, any sort of inducement, any sort of threat or any sort of promise. If all these three things are absent, inducement, threat, promise, if it is going to be absent, in other way, what it would mean is that this confession could be taken that as if it is taken voluntarily. That is the main purpose for which the 24 says that it should be away from, it should not fall within the ambit of the confession which is given, should not have been made by means of this threat, promise, inducement. Behind the section 24, if you see, you have to go to article 20, subarticle 3, subclass 3 of the Constitution of India, where it says no person can be compelled to be a witness against himself. So a person who is accused of any offense cannot be compelled to be a witness against him so as to get the conviction. So this is what the article 23 of the Constitution, 20 subclass 3 of the Constitution. This 20 subclass 3 of the Constitution, which falls under the fundamental right, which is a part 3 of the Constitution of India, which is almost like a birthright which has been given to us for the purpose of having a free life, for ensuring the life and liberty under 21 of the Constitution of India. Life and liberty says, but article 21 says, no one can be deprived of the fundamental right except in due process of law or except the procedure in accordance with the law. So a person's liberty could be deprived. A person's movement could be deprived. And individual movement could be deprived only in accordance with the procedure established by law. That's what the article 21 guarantees. So in accordance with this article, if you read it along with the 20 subclass 3, no one can be compelled to be a witness against himself. If he is compelled to be a witness against himself, it would be very easy for the investigation officer or any investigation agency under threat or promise or under the temporal nature treatment, they can say that you have to give the confession that you have done this commission of offense. Therefore, they will record the statement and ultimately will land up in without having any collection of any evidence, without investigating it properly, a person could be under the threat or promise, under the threat and influence, or by temporal nature, the third grade treatment, they could be subjected to any sort of torture and the confession could be extracted. So therefore, 25 says, it only says the voluntariness ensured. Ensure the voluntariness. you have to read the 24 section 24 of the Evidence Act along with section 28. I'll come later to that part. So what 28 says and what 24 says, virtually that's diagonally, it will be opposite to each other. And that also, the 28 also will deal with the same threat, inducement and promise. 24 also will deal with the threat, inducement and promise. What 24 will say is, 24 will say, if it is done with the threat, inducement and promise, it is irrelevant. 24 says, 28 says, if you remove the impression that it has not been obtained, the court should have an impression after the removal of the impression, it has not been obtained by threat, promise, inducement, then it becomes relevant. 24 says of, speaks of the irrelevancy, but 28 speaks of the relevancy. So therefore, in conjoint reading of the 24 and 28, what the statute would mean, what the intent of the lawmaker is, that this, the whatever the confession that's been extracted or it's been given from the, you not extracted, it's, the word is wrong, it's given by the accused, it should be voluntary. If it is not going to be voluntary, then it cannot be admissible as evidence as per the section 24 of the Evidence Act. 25 is whenever the accused is taken into police custody or even not taken into police custody, or if it goes to some other place and some other area or some other country, if he gives any confession to any police officer, it becomes, it cannot be proved at all. It does not speak of relevancy or irrelevancy. It cannot be proved at all before the court of law. It cannot enter into the court at all in the court of law. That's what the confession to the police officer, that is section 25 of the Evidence Act. Then 26 of the Evidence Act is an extension to the 20, extension to the 25. 25 says given to the police officer, but 26 says in the custody of the police officer. If it is going to be in the custody of the police officer, then it has to be in the immediate presence of the magistrate. 26 mandates that it should be done in the immediate presence of the magistrate. If the magistrate is to record, then he has to go to the procedure under section 164 of the Evidence Act, 164 of the CRPC, where the accused should be brought to the magistrate. The magistrate will ask, he will say him, warn him, he has to warn. The first duty of the magistrate is to warn him that you are not bound on duty. You are not bound to give such evidence. If you give such a confession, then it will be used against you for the purpose of conviction. So you are not bound and you can take a relaxation. You can come tomorrow and tell me whether you are voluntarily inclined to give the confession. So if he comes tomorrow and still he says that I am voluntarily giving a confession, and the magistrate has to record a footnote as per section 164 of the CRPC, Evidence Act, it is under CRPC. Under section 164 of the CRPC, he has to write a footnote at the bottom of the confession saying that I gave the warning, and this, apart from the warning, I said that it will be used against you, and the confession, I believe that the confession is voluntarily. I believe that the confession is voluntarily. That is a key word, an important word, and very vital word that has been provided, stipulated in the footnote of the CRPC, the 164 sections, 164 subclass 4 or 5, I think. Subclass, it must be in subclass 4. And it should be recorded. He has to ensure that it's been given in the voluntariness. I believe that's been given in voluntariness. That's what the judgment, this judgment Chandran versus State, that deals with that case. That in that judgment, the confession was recorded, it will be recorded by the magistrate saying that I hope it is voluntarily. That the judgment will distinguish what is hope and what is voluntarily. The hope cannot be equated with the voluntariness. So therefore, this confession is not as per the, in accordance with the procedure established under section 164 of the CRPC. Therefore, it cannot be taken into consideration. So you see the difference between the word, single word, which changes the admissible fate of the confession, whether it could be admitted or not admitted, whether it is relevant or not relevant, whether it could be taken into consideration for the purpose of conviction or not. So this is the relevancy, whether reliable part of it or not. This Chandran versus State has been dealt with in the very famous case that's been given by Honorable Justice Nagamuthu in Dindigul Rajkumar versus State. That is a doctor by name, Dr. Bhaskar, would have been kidnapped in Dindigul. He would have been murdered. He will be murdered. And the body will be thrown in the Aliyar Dam, which I discuss. This is what the extract. I just wanted to give an extract, then I want to give the continuity of my lecture. This is what the extract of the last session which we had. For the purpose of understanding this 24, this is an extra, it is called as an extrajudicial confession. There are only two types of confession which we can say. One is a confession which is given to the magistrate, that is a judicial confession. The other confession is a confession which is an extrajudicial confession, other than that of the magistrate, to whomsoever. It may be an officer, it may be an RDO, it may be a tahsildar, it may be a VAO, it may be a friend, father, it may be a wife, or it may be somebody else. To whom the accused is having a reposing a confidence. So he says, out of this confession, some of the judgment that's been dealt with is a confessional, an emotional outburst. It is crippling in the mind. It's crippling in your mind, saying that you have committed a mistake. So this is an outcome of this emotion. By means of this confession, it's coming out, and it has to be given before somebody who is well known, where we can share our thought, and the judgment. I will tell you that judgment speaks of that the heaviness in the heart is relaxed by means of the confession. The crippling mind is now relaxed. Therefore, it's an emotional outburst. This is what the confession is defined. So this 24, as far as the 24 is concerned, it is a weak piece of evidence. Extrajudicial confession is a weak piece of evidence, and also it could be a substantive evidence. It is a substantive piece of evidence, no doubt about it. But always it is treated as a weak piece of evidence if at all any doubt is created in the confession. First thing is what I said, confession should be voluntarily. If there is a doubt in the mind of judge, or if does not inspire the confidence of the court that this confession would have been obtained by means of some threat or promise or inducement, then the judge may look for any corroboration, any material that is required to support the confession. He may look for it and may then after satisfying himself it is properly corroborated, sufficiently corroborated, it serves to inspire the confidence of the court to land up in conviction. This 24, very easily you can understand this section 24, how it is distinguished or how it is voluntarily, casual manner it will come out of the mouth of the accused somewhere in some place. To somebody. It will very voluntarily, it will come out of that confession. If it is that is going to be deposed by the person to whom it has been disclosed, to whom it has been confessed, then that becomes a substantive piece of evidence. As against the maker, it falls under section 24. For this purpose of this 24, and this 24 is so well connected with section 30, and the section 30 is also connected. It's in the different concept. It is connected to section 10 of the Evidence Act. For these three different things, to understand the three different sections, how it has to be applied practically, you would have to go to the judgment called N. Banu versus State of Tamil Nadu, which is a very famous judgment that's been rendered by Honorable Justice Narayanamuthu. This, why I'm saying this judgment of the High Court is that for the easy understanding, this clarity that's been given in the judgment is very easy for me to understand. So you can also understand the same. Some judgments, if you read that, it's very, may not be able to understand, and the concept may not be clear. And this, so I'm digging out the, what are the judgment I'm saying here. I am digging out those judgments which could be used for the purpose of easy understanding of the sections and the concepts provided in the section, the principle underlying in the sections. For this 24, again, we will have to start with the 24 to understand up to section 30. So therefore, if I'll share a small chart with you. I'll give the gist of the facts that's happened in this Banu's case. Banu case is nothing but the case of a famous, the former chief minister, Mr. M.G. Ramachandran's foster son by name. His name is Mr. Vijay Kumar. He has been murdered the allegation is that he has been murdered by some of his close relative or sister-in-law. Sister-in-law was, she was arrayed as A1. Then A1, A2 is a very close associate of that A1. She'll say that A2 will engage first PW 79, who will subsequently become an approver. He will engage 79, you will say that somehow this man has to be eliminated from the earth for the purpose of helping AO. This is what the concept is. I'll make you some payment and arrangements. We will negotiate for 5 lakhs. You have to say, I'll give you 5 lakhs to 79. I'll share a document with you. And if you could see that, please. I'll explain with the document what is. This document is visible. The document is visible, madam?
No, yes, sir. I think the document is not yet visible. You have shared the screen of your desktop. You have
just a minute.
You have to pinpoint the correct document.
Yeah, I'll just take it. Last time also I had the same problem. Now is it, madam?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Now you have given a clear picture. I have given. Please, please go through the picture minutely, and I'll just enlarge it also. I'll just try to enlarge it. From out of this, you can understand three provision. What is conspiracy? You can understand. What is Section 24? How it has to be applied? You can understand. Then also you can understand Section 30 of the Evidence Act. What is the effect of the confession of a maker, effect of the confession of somebody with respect to the non-maker? I am an co-accused. I did not get any confession. Somebody is giving confession who has joined with me in the crime. So what is the effect of the confession as against him, as against me? Both has to be understood. That's what I have explained here, along with the Section 10 of the Evidence Act. That is a conspiracy. You see, I have given a chart. I think that your chart is clear now. To some extent, I think that chart would be clear. See, A2 says that I'll pay you now 50,000 rupees to 79. 79 is here. 79 is here. Now the deal is between A2 and 79. Total amount that's been negotiated is 5 lakhs once the murder is completed. Total amount is 5 lakhs once a murder is completed. So A2 here, A2 pays 50,000 to 79. That is a conspiracy now being developed. That A2 now pays rupees 50,000 to 79. 79 comes and deposits before the court. I received 50,000. I engaged A3. Here is the A3. You see this, here is A3 is here. A3 is here, A2 is here. The deal is A2 to 79. 79 engages A3, says that we'll have to finish off a particular person. I will give you money and we will share the amount, whatever is coming. So therefore, get ready for the assignment and be prepared for this assignment accomplishment. So this is how the conspiracy develops. Conspiracy has yet not been completed. Conspiracy is the offense that's been conspired now has not been accomplished. It's not been finished yet. It is still in. Is to be executed. We are now planning. A2 gives 50,000, and the 50 part of the 50,000, that is 10,000 rupees, goes to A3. PW79 pays 10,000 rupees to A3. A3 now receives 10,000 for the purpose. What is the purpose? Conspiracy is now being hatched. What is the purpose? To target the deceased. His name is Vijay Kumar, Mr. Vijay Kumar. Now, this has been done during the existence of the conspiracy. Conspiracy has not been accomplished into a murder. And before, during the subsistence of the conspiracy, it is happening. What is that? My acceptance, 79's acceptance of 50,000 rupees and paying rupees 10,000 rupees to 70, A3. Then thereafter, as per the facts of the case, thereafter, A2 takes 79 to Ramavaram Totem. And seeing Ramavaram Totem, he comes to know, 79 comes to know, he is a former chief minister of Tamil Nadu. How can I touch his son? then the person was also identified. There was some Santro car was identified. This is the person. The person will drive the Santro car. You have to hit the Santro car with some mode of by some ambassador or some vehicle, and you have to dash and you have to make it as an accident. This is what the first plan that's been plotted. And 79, he goes and sees it, and he sees that no, he is the former chief minister of Tamil Nadu. If he touch that, he definitely certainly we will get into trouble. So better we can withdraw from this. That's what he felt inside. And he ultimately came and said the A3 that it's a very big shot person who has to be targeted. Therefore, I do not want to do the deal. So you also withdraw from the deal. We'll just forget it. We'll drag it on. We'll do it. Something. So you be careful about it and don't try to accomplish this. And keep the money with you. I'll keep the money with me. That's it. 79 says this to the A3. A2 was waiting for about 2 or 3 months. It was not accomplished. Then he said that you get me the number A17, PW79 says, ultimately having waited for some time, A2 got the number of A3, and A3 and A2 directly came in link with each other. Then A2 influences A3 for the purpose of accomplishing the task, and A3 goes along with A4, A5, A6 and A7 also, who gives some car and other things. And he goes and he dashes in some Kotturvaram bridge or Kotturvaram bridge, crosses and makes the disease to stop the car. The disease is coming out. He was beaten with wooden locks and other arwal and other things. And he was made to die. He died. This is what the simple facts of the case. So what my point is here is, you please see, whatever is done, said, done, written, what Section 10 says of the Evidence Act pertaining to the conspiracy. I am not now in the confession. I am in the conspiracy. It's for the better understanding. I am putting this chart and I am explaining to you. See, conspiracy is what it defines. Conspiracy under Section 120B, what it defines. It's an agreement between two or more persons to do an illegal act or a legal act by means of an illegal, illegal means. Doing a legal act by means of illegal. So we will take directly. Doing an illegal act by means of an agreement, by means of a meeting of the mind. It's an agreement, it will not be written. But agreement on the basis of the mind, meeting of the mind. So the reason to believe what section, now this 120B says, this is an agreement to do an illegal act. This illegal act may be whatever may be the illegal act. It may be a murder, it may be a forgery, it may be a theft or whatever it is. But the punishment of 120B will be that what is the offense that's been conspired, that punishment will be awarded to 120B commission. If I'm going to conspire to commit a theft, theft is going to be committed. What is the offense that's been given for the theft? That will be given to the 120B. If the conspiracy is for the murder, when life or death, that punishment will be life or death, with the death penalty or capital punishment or life imprisonment. So that punishment will be acquired, or will be given to this 120B will acquire the punishment of the offense that's been conspired. If you are conspiring for the murder, then the punishment for the murder will go to the 120B. So therefore, the charge is 120B read with 302. On seeing the charge, you can immediately say that what is the offense conspired. 120B read with 302. If the murder has been committed, 302 read with 120B, because the murder 302 has been committed in pursuance of the 120B. This is the explanation I can give. So now you can see this is a place where the commission has been obtained. This is a place where the offense had been committed. So up to this, from the beginning of the conspiracy, A2 to here, offense committed, what are the things done, said, done, written? Section 10 says, if you have reasons to believe two or three persons have conspired together to do an illegal act by means of a common intention, and whatever said, done, or written are relevant for the purpose of proving the existence of the conspiracy and for the purpose of proving who are all the party thereto. There are two important things in Section 10 of the Evidence Act, which we can read later. We'll read after finishing this chart. The reasonable ground must be there. And the reasonable ground is for what? For the purpose of, there are two persons entering into an agreement for the purpose of committing an illegal act by means of a common intention. In that occasion, what are the things said, done, or written during the subsistence of the conspiracy are all relevant, are all relevant. So here, the 79's deposition, I received 10,000 rupees is relevant under section 10 of the Evidence Act. I gave rupees 10,000 to A3, that becomes relevant under section 10 of the Evidence Act. And A3 also agreed for commission of the crime, that is also under section 10 of the Evidence Act. So here, so therefore in the bracket I have said, see the bracket here which I have placed, this is a bracket. It's a bracket I have said, this falls under section 10 of the Evidence Act. Complete this transaction from 50,000 that's been negotiated, 50,000 that's been received as a booty or as a contract amount, and 10,000 that has been shared with the A3, all these things are falling under section. This is this whatever said, done, or written, that is, that's conspiracy. So this is falling under section 10. See, the beauty of the section 10 is, see, I depose before the court that this is what has happened. 50,000 has been received and 10,000 has been given to A3 also. So this piece of evidence is a substantive piece of evidence, not only against the maker, that is PW 79, and also a substantive piece of evidence as against the A3 also. Whatever is said, done, or written during the substance of the conspiracy is a substantive piece of evidence as against all the persons, since he has been approver and he has got a pardon in section 306 and 307 of the IPC, he is now escaped. He is now no more an accused, now he is standing as a witness. But that evidence which is falling under section 10 will be a substantive piece of evidence, not only against the maker and also against the non-maker also, not like that of section 30. Whereas under section 24, A3, now we'll come to next by this one. For explaining the 24 and 30, now I come to the next stage of the case. Okay. Now, here the offense had been now accomplished. Murder has been committed in the night about 8 o'clock or 7:30 or 8 o'clock. Now it has been completed. Next day comes in the newspaper that such and such person, who is a foster son of former minister MGR, former chief minister MGR, has been murdered near so-and-so place, and he has been taken to Apollo Hospital and he was declared dead. This is a news that has been seen by the 79, PW79. PW79 had a doubt in his mind whether A3 would have committed it or not, because he is also in the line of conspiracy. So therefore, he immediately calls A3 that whether you have committed or not, you tell me that. A3 here discloses, yes, I committed it. We committed it. I myself, along with my lieutenants, I committed it, and you keep quiet, don't disclose it to anybody else. And if you disclose it to anybody else, then you will also have to face the same consequence of it. Please don't disclose it. That task is finished, completed, accomplished. There is nothing to talk about it more. That's what the A3 says. A3 here confesses to 79. This is coming into the deposition of the testimony of the 79. A3 here confesses to 79 that we completed the task along with A3, A4, A5, A6. Now, this A3 confession to the 79, admission to the 79, will fall under section 24 of the Evidence Act, that is extrajudicial confession given voluntarily without any threat, promise, inducement. It voluntarily comes out from the mouth of the A3. This piece of evidence will fall under section 24, admissible. And with respect to the A3, A4, A5, and A6, with respect to the A4, A5, and A6, non-maker, I did not make any confession. A4, I am A4, or A5, or A6, I did not make any confession. But A3 made a confession to the 79, that too extrajudicial confession. A3 confession to 79 is 24, falls under section 24 of the Evidence Act. With respect to the A4, A5, and A6, the same confession will fall under section 30 of the Evidence Act. Please understand this. Be careful. Be very keen in understanding it. With respect to the maker of the confession, it will fall under section 24. If it is going to be free from threat and promise inducement, it's a substantive piece of evidence which should inspire the confidence of the court. whereas with respect to the non-maker A4, A5, A6, non-makers A4, A5 and A6, it is a corroborative piece of evidence only in the joint trial. That's what section 30 says. In the joint trial, it is a corroborative piece of evidence and it could be used for the purpose of corroborating other materials available as against A4, A5, A6. So, on evidence, the court has to see, simply because of A3 has given this confession, the court cannot convict A4, A5, A6. The confession is that clear. A3 confession is clear. I did along with A3, A4, A5, A6. That A3 confession is clear. But as because A3 has given the confession, court simply cannot close eyes and convict A4, A5 and A6. But it has to see the other material on record. What are all the other evidences available for the purpose of convicting A4, A5, A6, and the confession which is given by A3 could be used for the purpose of corroborating the other material evidences. That is what the section 30 says. Consideration of the proved confession with respect to the as against the maker, affecting the maker and affecting the non-maker in case of joint trial. If it is not a joint trial, split trial. If it is a split trial, then this confession, suppose assume that A4, A5, A6 have escaped. Now the case is now split as against the A2, A3 and A4, A5, A6. Split trial has come. But in this split trial, whether this confession that is given by the A3 could be used or not. But section 30 says only in the joint trial it is a corroborative piece. It could be considered. But in the split trial, there is no evidentiary value at all. If you can see, a recent judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court, Raja Ayyappan pertaining to the Tada case. It's before Honorable Supreme Court. You can note down the judgment and search it in the internet. It will come. And this difference will be clearly, it's been explained there also. In case of, if you want any Supreme Court judgment, you can make use of this Raja Ayyappan case. This is how this 24, section 10, 24, and section 30 could be explained. I hope that you would understand it. Now we'll go through the section also. And 24, if you could see, it says that I already explained that it should be free from threat promise inducement. Section 25, police. 26 to the magistrate. 28, again, we will come to the 27. But 24 and 28 are connected, so connected. So therefore, we will deal with the 28. Then thereafter, we'll come to the 27 of this. I hope that this is, I'll share the next chart. Somebody is getting admitted, but I'm not able to see the section. See, section 24, I'll see here. Confession caused by the inducement threat promise when irrelevant in the case of criminal proceedings under the temporal treatment, temporal nature treatment, and the accused would gain some advantage out of this, confession. Judge is feeling like this. He is going to gain some advantage out of this. Then it will be hit by irrelevancy. If you simultaneously, if you go to section 28, confession made after the removal of the impression caused by the threat promise inducement. If the confession referred under section 24 is made after the impression caused by such inducement threat promise, as in the opinion of the court has been removed, then it is relevant. So what it ensures, 24 and 28 both ensures that it should be voluntariness. It should not have been influenced by any sort of influence from the police that I have committed it. That A3 confession to the 79 is not out of any influence even before the arrest. Even before the arrest, immediately there is a sure nexus and close proximity between the the incident and the next day that confession that's been made to the 79 first the conspiracy, the court will deal dealing 79 because that conspiracy has been now broken. And the second conspiracy has been developed between A2 and A3. And A2 got the number from the A3 and he continued the conspiracy with the A3 and this accomplished the task. So this also, this court will deal with this, as whether it is a part of the same course of same transaction or different transaction. Both the conspiracies are the interesting judgment. Banu case, if you go through the Banu case, you will come to understand about this three concepts, section 10, section 24, section 30 of the Evidence Act. So this I have done with. Now we will come to the, now this 24 and 28, please read together, join together. 28 speaks of relevancy, 24 speaks of irrelevancy in the case of three vices. In the case of removal of the three vices that's been stipulated in 24, you will come under section 28 also, and it's admissible and it's relevant and it is admissible. We can take it in that way. Okay. Then comes the section 27 of the Evidence Act. Section 27, you all must be knowing, and will be day-to-day life, you will be applying that, leading to how much of evidence, how much of confession that could be admissible, which is leading to discovery of the, distinctly leading to discovery of a fact, distinctly leading to discovery of fact. That is so, so important. Distinctly leading to discovery of the relevant fact. It's not a fact, it's a relevant fact that is leading to discovery of the relevant fact. So this section 27, you must be knowing that Atappa counter is the first case that is in 1936 by the Privy Council. The whole confession will be admissible. This is a knife through which I stabbed somebody. Yes. And this knife is there hidden in my house. And if you take me to the house, I'll take the knife and produce it. This whole statement is admissible as per the Atappa counter's case, very first case in 1936. This was holding the field till 10 years, 1946 or 47, till that Pulikuru Kottaya case came. Pulikuru Kottaya's case came, then ultimately he said, no, it's absolutely wrong. You cannot take the whole confession as a admissible part. Then it will prejudice the mind of the judge. Then it will hit section Article 23 of the Constitution that no one can be a witness against himself also. So compelled to be a witness against himself also. So only part of the confession, which is distinctly leading to the discovery of the fact, that alone is admissible, that is pertaining to the knowledge of his concealment. It is not the thing that is going to be discovered. Suppose I say that Arwal is kept there in my house. It is not the thing that I discovered the Arwal and keeping it in my house. It means that what is my knowledge, the knowledge in concealing the weapon that is used for the purpose of commission of the offense. Knowledge in concealing the weapon that is used for the purpose of commission of the offense. That is what the discovery. If you want, for 27, these are the two important cases. I can say that this Pulikuru Kottaya's case now says that holds the field for all along now till about 90 years. Now, almost it's about 80 years. It is holding the field. What is the portion which is distinctly leading to discovery of the fact, that alone is admissible. The rest of the portion cannot be seen at all, cannot be admitted at all before the court of law. That is what the, if you want a very good judgment for this understanding of the section 27, I'll say that one anomalous case that is also by Honorable High Court of Madras rendered by Honorable Justice Nagamuthu. It's a very interesting case. The accused and the deceased will be the, they have the relationship of the lessor and lessee. Anomaly, that is, it's a Mecheri police station or not Mecheri, it's a Mettur police station somewhere. If you want, I will take the judgment also. I'll share the document. Now we are in 27. Okay, I'll just take out the document if possible. Please note on this criminal appeal and this, I'll give a small narration about this case. And Chittoor police station, not Mettur. It's a Chittoor police station, E Road, very close to E Road. Very interesting case. And the deceased will have a marble shop, which will be leased out to the accused. some trouble in the marble shop. That's it. Leasing and giving money or something else. The entire family of the deceased will come to Mettur for the purpose of some death ceremony. And you will say, all the family will be in Mettur. The deceased will say, I'll go to marble shop and check whether the payment is coming or not, something like that. For the purpose, he will go to the marble shop. And from the moment he entered the marble shop, he will be missing. There will be a last call that will be recorded by the deceased to his wife that I am in the marble shop. It's about 6:30 p.m. in the evening. After that 6:30 p.m. in the evening, and another half an hour or 1 hour, the mobile shut down and no calls, no correspondence. They were waiting for about one day and no information about the deceased. Immediately the wife proceeds to Chittor and checks whether Bhavani, I think, it checks whether he got information that he left by about 5:30. By 6:30, the call was received from the deceased to his wife's phone number. He is now, man missing case was first registered. Then after missing 2 days, the shop was closed. That marble shop did not open. The deceased, the accused, Anamalai, his mobile was switched off. His mobile was switched off. See the contact of this. This contact will fall under section 8 of the Evidence Act. See, his mobile switched off. Why the shop has been closed, which will give a doubt. Immediately, this is a place where he says to his wife that I come to the shop, marble shop. This is a place last he visited. But immediately day onwards, that shop was closed. They did not open the shop. 2 days he was completely absent. And third day or fourth day, he surrenders before somebody else, before some magistrate in Salem. And he was taken into police custody. Then he was brought to the shop. Then police got a doubt, why should the shop be closed for about 2 days? He opened the shop. There were some blood stains that were found in the Dinathandi paper. Blood stains were in the newspaper. And two or three drops of blood stains were in the some mosaic stones were lying in the office. Mosaic stones. Being a marble shop, some mosaic stones also will be there. No, it was lying there. And again, some 3-4 blood drops alone were found in the some plastic chair where used to sit for the visitors, which was used for the purpose of sitting visitors. So all the 3 blood samples were collected by the police. He asked the explanation, what is this blood sample? And how these blood samples came here, what is the explanations from you? Because being a holder of the shop, he is in possession of the shop. The owner of the shop has to give the explanation and why this has happened. For the employee, one small boy will be employed in that shop. He will be given a leave for about 10 days time. Why would he give a leave for the boy also? This is also one of the questions that was crippling in the mind of the investigation officer. So this, all the things led, they recovered the blood. And ultimately the court said, I'll directly come to the result. Ultimately the court will say, this recovery of the blood, drop of blood, is a relevant fact. How? I'll come to the point later. I have not completed the story yet. How this is relevant fact? This is a relevant fact which will fall under section 27 of the Evidence Act, leading to discovery. This is the confession. He says that he will say that I beat him in the marble shop and he was murdered here. I took him the gunny back. His body was cut into so many parts. Torso was cut, head was cut separately, limb was cut, and his lower limb was cut, leg were cut, and everything has been cut. And it was dropped in the Mettur Dam's outflow, the place where the highest and fastest water outflow will be there. In that place, he places the gunny bag in that area. One of the area that's been identified by the accused. So this small drop of blood will be subjected for DNA examination. From out of the DNA examination, this DNA examination will be compared to the daughter of the deceased. He will give her blood and that blood sample will be analyzed. And ultimately, that blood sample will connect the daughter of the blood sample with the blood sample that's been detected in the marble shop. So the DNA test will prove that the blood that has been collected from the marble shop is the blood of the biological father of the daughter of the this PW1. So the daughter's blood is the biological daughter and biological father. This will connect. So ultimately, the court will come to this investigation officer come to the conclusion something has happened there, and he has been beaten up there, and he was beaten to death in the marble shop itself. He goes in the deceased goes in the motorbike. That motorbike was kept in some bus stand somewhere very close nearby town, some station, Sangagiri or somewhere, and that bus stand, that motorbike was recovered. The deceased jewels were pledged in, not pledged, it was sold in some jewelry. From that jewelry, the deceased jewels were required, and the deceased will be wearing an earphone, that's dumb and deaf, there's a little hearing impaired phone. That also will be kept in the gunny bag, and it will be thrown along with the dead body. Its banyan will be there, its shirt will be there, and the police will go to that place where the water flow was there, and they were not able to get the body of the deceased, because the body of the deceased was cut into small pieces, and it was put in a gunny bag, and it was eaten up by the fishes over there in the river. Ultimately, a small pond of flesh was obtained. A gunny bag will be recovered, but by the great swimmers in this area, those who can swim in the very high current, and the swimmers will get into that, and they will bring two or three pieces of small one gunny bag will be there. In the gunny bag, nothing, no body, nothing else, all will be eaten by the fish, and only what remains will be the small pond of fish, that earring phone, and some banyan and shirt. This is what could be identified. This is that of the deceased. Here, the body is not at all detected. In this case, the body is not at all found out. Corpus delicti is not at all been detected. But ultimately, all the complete circumstances of the case pinpointed that this is the accused, who has committed the offense. He has no explanation to offer, or a plausible explanation to offer to justify that I have not committed this offense, or to say that this is how this incident has happened, and I am nowhere responsible for this incident. I was not in the shop, or I was not in the possession of the shop on a particular day, and all these things are completely pinpointed. How this is leading to the what is this all under Section 27 of the Evidence Act. For that only I have given all this story. Section 27 of the Evidence Act, if you take any fact, any confession, which is any statement which is given by the accused to the police, which is distinctly leading to the discovery of the relevant fact. So that will fall under Section 27 of the Evidence Act. So therefore, what are the things here which led to the statement? What are the things that's been recovered on the base of the statement here? See, you have seen that area where the body was thrown. You have taken up the bike, Sangagiri police bus stand, somewhere in Sangagiri bus stand. You have recovered the jewels that's been pledged or sold in a particular jewelry shop in somewhere in Mettur, somewhere close to the Mettur, Kolathur, I think. That were required, and this banyan shirt and the hearing impaired hearing phone that was recovered. All these things, even police recover also where the headphone was purchased, and this headphone was purchased by the deceased from the shop. The shop owner will come and depose that. So all these circumstances will clearly pinpoint, without direct evidence, that he has committed the murder. Is wholly on the basis of the circumstantial evidence, which is pinpointing that the chain of circumstances. If it is a circumstantial, Goinda versus State, that's a Supreme Court judgment. If you see, what are the cases where in circumstances, in the absence of the direct evidence, what are the cases in which the circumstantial, on the basis of the circumstantial evidence, you can convict a person? All the circumstances that's been relied upon by the prosecution should form a complete chain. The chain should not have any break at all. And the chain should be without any missing link. And there is no other hypothesis that available inconsistent to the guilt of the accused. There's no other hypothesis should be available. If any hypothesis available inconsistent to the guilt of the accused or with the innocence of the accused, then it will give a benefit of doubt to him and he will be acquitted. But the fourth one is so important. No other hypothesis should be available for the purpose of showing that something is inconsistent to the guilt of the accused. If all these things are, four or five conditions are satisfied, the circumstantial evidence will clearly, it will prove and pinpoint that this accuser has committed the offense and therefore he could be convicted. This is so important, the judgment, Annamalai versus State of Tamil Nadu, Chittoor Police Station, Crime Number 724, Criminal Appeal Number 729 of 2016. Please go through that for the purpose of understanding where the Honorable Judge has dealt with the Pulikuru Kottaya's case. I have marked all important areas where if I detail everything, I will not be able to complete this evidence act even in 1 week. So I'll have to go very fast, at least. I cannot move even 2-3 sections. All this important area which I have studied, I have marked here. And I'll show that important, the judgment which you'll have to must and mandate you have to go through is, for the purpose of the section 27 is, Pulikuru Kottaya. Puli, you can note out this. This is one. Please note down this, Emperor Pulikuru Kottaya versus King Emperor, 1947, 1 MLJ, 2010 criminal. Please, you can note down this judgment and it's very important. With your permission, I'll take some water. I hope that you would have seen this. We'll go back to the Indian Evidence Act again. Every time it's going missing. So 27 I have completed, 28 I have completed, 29, this is something similar to section 11. The confession which is otherwise relevant, not to become irrelevant because of the promise of secrecy. So if the confession is going to be obtained by means of secrecy, I'll keep it secret. You please give the, you say what is the truth, I'll keep the secret. On the, you cannot, the accused cannot take a defense saying that it was under the promise of secrecy I gave it. So therefore cannot be admissible. Otherwise it should be relevant. Otherwise relevant means that it should pass the test of voluntariness. So if this is the case, otherwise relevant will not become irrelevant because of the five things. Some five things are stated here. One is promise of secrecy. Second one is deception. Yamati confession. Third one is the drinking. Some, he will be administered with some alcohol or something else. In an inebriated mood, he will get the confession. Some officer, police officer might get it in an inebriated mode of the accused. All these defenses cannot be taken by the accused. If it is going to be otherwise relevant, but ensure it's relevant first. Ensure relevant first means that it should be voluntary first. Unless it's a voluntary, you cannot ensure this one. It should be first, it should be voluntarily. Then as because it's voluntarily, as because it's a promise of secrecy, as because it's it was under the drunk and inebriated mode, as because he was deceived. Deception has been effected, and by means of the deception, the confession was obtained. And another two is that, and also we can say that in some of the answers to the question, I voluntarily, by slip of the tongue, I gave it. And another one is, as because I was not warned, like what is the warning that is given in the 164 statement? I should be warned that I am not bound to give this as a statement. Such a warning has not been given. This is applicable for the extrajudicial confession. This is for the extrajudicial. Such a warning has not been given to me. And if such a warning would have given, I would not have given this confession. All these defenses are not available as because of the section 24, 29 of the Evidence Act. Please go through that. It's very simple to understand. Once you understand the concept of this 24 and 30, it will be easy for you to understand the 29 also. And 30, which I already explained, that just I'll go through the section, consider consideration of the proved confession affecting the person making it and others jointly under trial for the same offense. If more than one person being tried jointly for the same offense and the confession made by one of such a person affecting himself and other person of such person is proved, others of such person is proved, the court may take into consideration of such confession as against other persons as well as against the person who is making such a confession. This is what is the definition and the exact phrases in the class. But what is the real application is, with respect to the maker, it becomes a substantive piece of evidence. With respect to the non-maker, it becomes a corroborative piece of evidence. That is the consideration of the proved confession affecting the person making it. If making it, for the person making it, it becomes a substantive piece. Without being a compulsion, without being any influence or other thing, it could be convicted. It becomes a, if it inspires a confidence, it's a substantive piece, but it's a weak piece. If it does not inspire confidence, they will look for a corroboration. This is with respect to the maker of the confession. With respect to the non-maker, they have to see what are all the other evidences and materials available. If other evidences and materials are available, this co-accused confession could be used for the purpose of corroboration of the confession, corroboration of the main evidences, substantive evidences. This is what the section 30 deals with, and it's very easy to understand. We'll go to next important provision, and admission not conclusive proof but may save. We always, it's applicable in it's applied in the civil case. Admission could be rebutted, admission could be disproved and other things, so therefore it cannot be taken as a conclusive proof. That's what the section says, very simple to understand. Then we'll go to the next important section, that is section 32. That's a dying declaration. This dying declaration, and the next one is dying declaration is pertaining to the statement of relevancy. Relevancy pertaining to the statement given by the person who is dead. Then 33 is the record of evidence, relevancy of record of evidence. Relevancy as to pertaining to record of evidence on record. Something, the evidence that's been given in the previous judicial proceedings. And what is the relevancy for that of the person who is of a dead? So 33 is speaking of the simple statement, relevancy of the statement. 32 speaks of simple relevancy of statement, and 33 speaks of the record of evidence given by the dead person or a person who cannot be found, cannot be brought to the court without any expenses. And what is the relevancy thereof? That is what the section 33 says. So important is 32. 32 is a dying declaration. Then dying declaration, along with the dying declaration, if you see, there will be other 7-8 provisions will be there. Not only the dying declaration which will be relevant, any statement made by the person who is dead, pertaining to some 8 examples are there, made in course of the business, pertaining to the book of accounts, what are the books, credit and debits, what are the amounts to be settled, all these things are relevant, falling under relevant in section 32 of the Evidence Act. If a person makes any statement against my own pecuniary interest or proprietary interest, that is also relevant. If a dead person made any statement pertaining to the public right and customs, that is relevant under section 32. Then pertaining to the relationship of blood relationship, adoption, marriage, a person assume that he will marry somebody else without disclosing to his wife. He will adopt somebody else without disclosing to his wife. He will have somebody else without disclosing to wife. Some baby would have been born or some child would have been born without coming to the knowledge of his wife. Any statement pertaining to the relationship, blood, marriage or adoption, all these statements are relevant under section 32. We always consider 32 for the purpose of dying declaration. It is not so. It is an extendable one. You see the extension that's been given, 5. I have said the relationship and any statement pertaining to the will and any statement which is pertaining to the section 13 of the Evidence Act and the feeling and the expression of these so many persons. That is also falling under section 32 of the Evidence. First, primarily, we will see that section 32, that's a dying declaration which is given in the criminal matters. Not only it is used for our dying declaration, but also other things also that 32 could be used. Dying declaration, the person is on the verge of death. And if he gives a statement pertaining to the cause of death or any transaction which is leading to the death, that is, here I'll say we'll take the first analysis session, and then the subsequent is the course of business and other against the pecuniary interest of the maker and public right and custom, all here explain. And so we can go through that for for the purpose of this 32 we'll discuss this pertain to the cause of death or the circumstances of transaction resulted in his death. He has been stabbed, he has been taken to the hospital. Yes, he will give a statement to the doctor that I have been stabbed by so and so. Then subsequently, he will be admitted in the hospital. Police officer will come and take the one statement. Judicial magistrate will come and take another statement. And thereafter, he will disclose something to his own relatives and this other who are attendants to that deceased who are present there. There will be a person can not only can state one single dying declaration, but also what are all the things that is he has said pertain to the cause of death and any transaction which is leading to the death. All these statements will fall under Section 32 of the Evidence Act. But thing is that it should be consistent, whether it is consistent or not. If it is going to be consistent, there are judgments to say that if it is going to be consistent, the judge inspires a confidence of if it inspires a confidence of the court, there is no bar at all to convict him. If it is going to be inconsistent, in so many cases I have read pertaining to Madras High Court of Honorable High Court of Madras, I have said on all the cases where the woman has been burnt with the fire, you will say, number one, this is an accident injury. Number two, you will say that it is a suicidal injury. Number three, you will say my husband has poured kerosene and he has set me fire. This will be a three different statements that will be given. If three different statements have been given, first statement to the doctor will be always like it's a fire. It's a fire accident. It's a stove accident. It's a burst of the cylinder. So and so. The next statement you will say it is a suicidal. I wanted to commit suicide. I burnt something like that. It's like that. Third, before the magistrate, no, they will implicate somebody else. My husband has made me like this and he has poured me. Before that intervening situation, the court also always look into who are all the relatives who have visited, who are all the relatives who have grudge on the husband, who are all the relatives who are having a grudge on the enmity or animosity on the as against the accused. So all these things will be seen, whether it is influenced, whether it is tutored, whether it is prompted. These are the three conditions which the court will analyze. And he will come to the conclusion that it's been influenced. Therefore, the credibility of the deceased is lost. Therefore, we cannot base the conviction on the base of this dying declaration. Maybe it has some evidentiary value, but what is the weightage that could be given? Whether it is sufficient for the purpose of effecting conviction or not? That is the important question that we have said that five tests has to be followed. First one is relevancy. Second one is admissibility. Third one is reliability. Fourth one is the weightage. Fifth one is the sufficiency. Then in the last two tests, if it is going to be inconsistent, then at last it will be hit by the fourth test and fifth test. The weightage and sufficiency will not be sufficient. If you want judgments for this, just note down these judgments which I will give. If you want judgment for the consistency, I'll give the same Madras High Court where you can very easy to understand this concept. It's a consistency based judgments where court will convict on the basis of the consistency. One Selva Ganapathy's case, everything is available in indiancanon.com. The moment you type that Selva Ganapathy Madras High Court dying declaration, something like that, immediately the judgment will come. I need not have to tell the citation. It's very difficult to search for that and write it also. Selva Ganapathy's case, one is Selva Ganapathy, second one is Gopal, third one is Kanakaraj. All these things are consistent dying declaration based on which conviction has been affected. Then inconsistency, where it's been ended in acquittal, you can write this Kankani, K-A-N-K-A-N-I, Kankani. Second one is Saravanan. Third one is Murugabhupathi. Fourth one is Arul Prasad. These are the four judgments which I can suggest for the purpose of understanding the concept of this dying declaration. If you further want any more judgment, I can tell you later. Some of the Supreme Court judgments also I can one Prempal and Ram Sagar. These are the two judgments rendered by the Supreme Court. Now how the dying declaration has to be relied upon, and whether it could be based, conviction could be well founded or not. So these are the one is Prempal, another one is Ram Sagar. These are the two judgments. You can take it from the Supreme Court website, and also the India Canon, it is available. This consistency and inconsistency are the important things which you have to bear it in your mind. So one another judgment is the Daleep Singh judgment. Daleep Singh judgment is a judgment that was rendered in 1976 judgment, where the dying declaration will be given to the police officer. It is, of course, it is relevant, because of course it is relevant, admissible, and reliable. Because 161 says anybody acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case, he has to give a statement to the, it can be examined. That examination is statement, outcome, answer, he is bound to give the true answer. Whatever is the true answer that's been given, it has to be reduced into the form of writing. And this statement under section 162 cannot be used for any purpose, not to be signed, and it could be used only for the purpose of contradiction under section 145 of the Evidence Act. For no other purpose it could be used. Exemption to the 161 and 162 is the statement given under section 27 of the Evidence Act, leading to discovery, and section 32 of the dying declaration given under section 32 of the Indian Evidence Act. These are the two exemptions that's been given to the 162, that is the statement which is given to the police officer. So when the law itself permits, when the statement given to the police officer, if he dies, then it could be used as a dying declaration. Yet the Supreme Court in Daleep Singh's case in 1976 or 79, in this case, Daleep Singh's case, said the police officers should always, they have to look for more reliable option of recording the dying declaration, either by the doctor or by the magistrate. You have to declare that dying declaration. You have to record the dying declaration by the magistrate or doctor, which would be more reliable than that of the police officer. But in case, if the police officer does not have any time to record that dying declaration, time is an essential. So if you do not record this dying declaration from this deceased, he will die immediately. There is no time limit for us, time to bring any officer like a judicial officer, neutral officers like a doctor or a judicial officers. And that time, they have to properly explain to the court that they did not have time to bring that officers immediately and to record their declaration. They have to satisfactorily, they have to explain to the court. So we do not have time, therefore we record, the investigation officer himself will record the dying declaration in that case, in Daleep Singh's case. So it was before recording the dying declaration by the magistrate and doctor, they have to ensure two things, that it's a fit state of mind and it is voluntary, Mr. Mas. It is a fit state of mind. He is in the mental capacity to give a dying declaration has to be ensured. The doctor has to certify that he is in the fit state of mind, he is in the conscious state of mind that to give capable of giving to give the dying declaration. This certificate is essential. Why this certificate is essential? Even without the certificate, the magistrate can put the questions which are rational to them and elicitate the answer. Suppose the magistrate comes, doctor is not available, the likely to die, the disease is like in the very critical condition, he may die at any point of time. Should I have to wait for the doctor? Being a magistrate has to satisfy herself or himself that she is capable of giving that, she is in such a fit state of mind for giving the dying declaration, proceed to go ahead with that. The doctor's certificate is for the purpose of prudence. It's a rule of prudence. So the rule of prudence, we ensure that she is in the disease in the capable, in the conscious mind or in the mental state of mind to give the dying declaration. That's how the doctor certificate is required. These are the requirements for the dying declaration, so as to get into the area of the reliability and weightage and sufficiency. This is how the 32. I have explained the 32. Similarly, like 32, 33 is like, that is a statement. This is the relevancy of the facts which are stated in the record of evidence which were given in the previous judicial proceedings or in the same judicial proceedings in the earlier stage. This record of proceedings, what are the facts which are stated therein are relevant. If the person is not found, cannot be brought to the court without any expenses, or cannot be brought to the court for some other reasons. So this is 33, which is says about the relevancy of the evidence on record. Evidence on record, how it is relevant, and whether the facts could be taken as a truth or not. This here it says that the evidence given by any witness in a judicial proceedings or by any person authorized to take it is relevant for the purpose of proving in the subsequent judicial proceedings or in the later stage of the same judicial, the truth of the facts stated therein. So it is relevant for the purpose of proving in the subsequent judicial proceedings, for the purpose of proving the truth of the facts which are stated therein. So this is how it has become. 33 is relevant. So we can divide the statement into two. What are the things? The statement is not the thing which is given in the court. What is given in the court is a testimony. What is given in the court is called a deposition. Or what is given in the court is called evidence. Because why? We have to go to Section 3 of the Evidence Act. So because under the oath, under the administration of oath, that I will not say any lie. I will say what are the things which I say are all truth. After administration of this, administering this oath only, they depose. They depose in the box, they depose on oath. So therefore, it has to be seen along with the Section 3. Section 3 mandates that the court permits or required to be permitted, the statement which a court permits are required to be required before it to be made. So these are the court either permits or requires him to make it. So this statement, when it is required by the court, when it is permitted by the court, it becomes a deposition or testimony or the evidence. So these are the important. So you have to understand the difference between the statement which is given to the person who is other than court and the evidence that is given to the court. So therefore, here it says this evidence on record. It's not here the statement. See the difference in the wording. Here it is saying that it is evidence given by the witness. There it is a statement of the person who is 32. I'm saying that 32 starts with statement, either written or verbal or relevant. 33 says evidence is given in the earlier proceedings. So this is the difference between the 32 and 33, which you can further detail, you can go through that. Then comes the 34 to 38. You can very well know about it, very simple to understand. 34 deals with the book of accounts. when book of accounts are relevant, book of accounts like credit, debit, what are the things happening in the bank and other things. For important things for 32, relevancy under Section 32, you can go to one judgment by call K. Venkatakrishnan versus State, CBI. Then second one is Ram Narayan Papali versus CBI. The both these cases deal with the Arshad Mehta's case. That is the share transaction that's been dealt with by the Arshad Mehta. A simple understanding, I'll give a brief fact of this. Every bank is mandated to maintain a cash reserve ratio. Some portion of the amount, they will keep it as a cash. Suppose say 100 crores I have circulated or rotated or given as a deposit or loan, and given as a loan. So of which 10% of it I should have, as per the mandate of the RBI guidelines, I should have mandate that 10% I should maintain as a cash reserve ratio. That is 10 lakhs at any point of time, a bank should at its end should have a 10 lakhs. If it is under crores, it is 10 crores would be the ratio that has to be kept in cash. It will vary by type to time. Sometimes it will be 12%, 15%, sometimes 8%, depends upon the inflation and all. So if the cash reserve ratio is going to get down, or I don't have 10 crores, but I have only 8 crores, then the bank is at liberty to buy it from the, to get it from the next bank, some other bank in the next street or next town or somewhere, please transfer me 2 crores for the deficit at the rate of 30% per annum. I'll repay it in 10 or 50 days. Moment my money comes, I'll immediately return back. So this is how the bank are mandated to compelled to maintain the ratios, cash reserve ratio or statutory liquidity ratio. That's what they call, two different ratios are to be maintained by the bank. So when a bank falling short of 3 crores, you will make a request to the another bank, please send me 3 crores. This 3 crores will not come to my bank account. Every bank will have its own account in the bank run by itself. It will have its own account saying the miscellaneous account, this account, this account, that account. So the amount transferred from the next bank, the nearby bank, should be credited in the bank account only. It should be in the name of the bank account. But it will not go to the one bank. It will go to the Ashit Mehta's bank account. Credit will be given. After 10 days, again with the same rate of interest, this amount, 3 crores, will again go back to that bank from where it has been borrowed. It will go back. There will be an entry, credit entry will be there, debit entry will be there. But the same credit entry, debit entry will not be there in the bank account. Bank account means the account, the saving bank or current account, miscellaneous account maintained by the bank itself. But no explanation could be offered. No explanation was not offered by any other bank official how it gone to the Ashit Mehta's account, how it returned back there. By mistake, you can say, but it cannot happen in all the 40 banks or 60 banks from which the money was taken. Within the 10 days or 15 days, he will rotate the money in the share market and he will make a profit out of it. 3 crores will become 30 crores. He will get back the money. And the moment the money is credited in his account, that money will again go back from his account to that bank, which is bank from whom the money was borrowed. This is how the transactions have been. All the transactions, Johnny Raman committee is there and committee has reported this is a case for investigation of the CBI. Frame of SCI, we have found bank offices do not have an explanation. Those who have taken a decision to borrow money for maintaining the cash reserve ratios and this statutory liquidity ratio, they have to explain how did this money that's been borrowed did not come to the bank account but went to the Harshad Mehta's account. This is how the explanation, these are the two important cases where you can go in detail and for the purpose of understanding the book of accounts under section 34 of the Evidence Act, you can go to this two sections. And then 35, you know that the revenue records that are being maintained by all revenue department and other things are all relevant. Patta, passbook, chitta book, and other passbooks those things are falling under section 35. Those things are relevant. And then 36 is a map, chart, and plans prepared by any government agency for the purpose of relevancy. You have to see the relevancy with respect to the fact and issue, and if they are going to be relevant, you can admit it under 36 of the Evidence Act. And 37 is any public act of public nature, like a notification and act. An act has been passed, Binami Prohibition Transaction Act. How will you really, we are reading a section here. What is the authenticity of it? This is relevant. Suppose if the particular act is required for deciding a case, for the proving or disproving the offense, commission of the offense. So that act is going to be read over, that is going to be relied upon. So that act is relevant under section 37 of the Evidence Act. That's also a presumption which will operate. We will come to that later point of time where when the presumption is going to be operated. And again, this is 38 is, you are using the law books, consolidated law books. I say that AR 1954, page number 45. How it is relevant? How what is the authenticity? That is, what are the things written there are true, correct statement that's been written in the correct the phrase or the statement that's been written in the judgment itself? What is that? How it is relevant? This is relevant under section 38 of the Evidence Act. There are then 39. If you come to 39, there will be some huge books you will be relying on, of which only two pages will be relevant for you. Is the whole book will be relevant for the purpose? No. Only the part of that which is required for the purpose of deciding the issue, that is alone relevant. If it is because of a series of letters, if it is because of a long conversation, if it is because of a series of books, only those parts which are used for, which are relevant to the issues, that alone will be relevant, that could be taken into consideration. That is what section 39 says. This is how this up to 39 goes. It's up 34 to 39 are the statements in the special circumstances. 32, 33, dying declaration and evidence on record, and 34 to 39 are the special circumstances statements. It's called. Then we come to the next 40. 40 is pertaining to the judgments. Previous judgment which has been obtained by fraud, or any previous judgment with respect to the same issue to bar the subsequent res judicata, subsequent suit, next suit again suit will be fine. The previous judgment is relevant. That's what 40 says. 44 says the judgment which has been obtained by fraud, collusion, or by the incompetent court. Those things are relevant. 41 says judgment pertaining to the probate. Those things are relevant. And any judgment which is pertaining to the issue which is connected or relevant under Section 43 of the Evidence Act. These are the four important sections which you have to bear in mind that pertain to the judgments which are going to be relevant in the issue. I'll give a small example. If you can read a judgment called Tirupati versus State, which is pertaining to Madurai case, dealt with the Honorable High Court of Madras. I think the Justice P.N. Prakash judgment, that is Honorable Justice P.N. Prakash judgment. It's a case of a murder. Husband will commit murder of his wife, and the boy, a small boy, will intervene. Boy will be pushed, very forcibly will push. His face will go and dash against the wall, and he also will die. This accused will run away along with the two daughters without informing the daughters that the mother has died and brother has died. He will have a chastity doubt on the wife, and he will be residing in the parents' house about three or four houses apart from the house where he is residing. In the midnight, the light will be burning, so she will be doubting the wife, and he'll go there and some mess will happen, and he will take the ear pulley and some screwdriver, and he will stab, and she will die, and the boy also will die. He will go back to the house of the parents, take the two daughters, escape to Kerala. He will escape to Kerala. And he will not attend the conduct. See the conduct of the accused, that he will not attend the funeral of his wife. He did not even, you will see that face of his son after the death at the time of the cremation. So these were the two incriminating evidence that the circumstances of incriminating in nature, which will be taken very seriously, will be taken against the accused. Apart from that, the two daughters also will be taken along with him. He will take along with him the two daughters. He will go to Kerala and he will reside there for about 10 or 15 days. The father will go and file a habeas corpus petition. Please think about the situation. The father will go and, whose father? That is his wife's father. That is the father-in-law of the accused. He will go and file a habeas corpus petition before the High Court of Madurai, I think. High Court will pass orders, produce the daughters before the court, and upon searching, they were somewhere in some home. They will bring back, and both the daughters will be produced before the court of law. And this judgment is relevant in the criminal murder case as against the accused. This is how the former judgments are relevant. So this is an example I am saying. The judgments, how relevant it could be in the criminal case. Previous judgment. This judgment is connected. He escaped along with the two daughters. Two daughters were brought into that same town by means of the habeas corpus petition, which is connected to the fact in issue, which is a relevant fact, which will fall under section 40 to 44, if not 44, not 40, 43, it will fall under section 43 of the Evidence Act. Please go through the judgment. This is a wonderful judgment. How the previous judgment and former judgments are relevant. This is a good example for that. Then comes the opinions of the experts. 45, you must be knowing the medical examination. That section 45 is this expert evidence, like medical or the postmortem report, how it is, what are the injuries that has caused. When you bring the doctor before the court, he will see the injury on his own sight, on his own vision, the injury will be there, whether it is incised or it is cut injury or it is lacerated injury or what is, how the injury has been caused, how the death has been caused, shock and hemorrhage or vasovagal shock or some other issue. All these things are the effect of the incident will. Therefore, the doctor's evidence will fall under section 7 also. This is an effect. You will see the effect of the fact in issue. What is the effect? There's a cut injury at the neck. You will see the effect of the injury. The effect of the fact in issue. A cut B. B is having a neck injury. E is a substantive evidence with respect to this injury, because he is seeing the injury. He is a substantive evidence. Then comes, he identifies the injury, whether it is a simple injury or grievous injury. Then, therefore, Yeah, since he is identifying that, it also will fall under Section 9 of the Evidence Act. And also he will give an expert opinion saying that whether this injury could cause a death or not. So therefore, it will fall under Section 45 also. So if you take a medical evidence can fall under Section 7, fall under Section 9 for identification of the time. So the doctor will say that the death would have been caused 24 hours to 48 hours prior to the postmortem, 24 to 48 hours, he will say. How will you say? What way it is relevant? It is relevant to Section 9 of the Evidence Act. He is identifying the time at which the death is caused. Falls under Section 9 of the Evidence Act. It's relevant under Section 9 of the Evidence Act. Then comes the 45. 45, he says, what is the cause? Whether this injury, suppose an injury has been caused in the finger. Sunduvarella or injury kuduthirukkaranga. Whether it will cause a death or not, opinion. His opinion is sought whether this injury will, it, this will not cause a opinion. Unless otherwise some septicemia or indirect, not direct effect. This injury will not cause direct effect on the body. So this is how the opinion has been obtained from him. So therefore it falls in Section 45. Now we recently introduced 45A, expert of the electronic evidence. So that's been used in attack Mandi case. All the pictures, photos, videos, that's been recorded by the media persons in and around at the time when the Dinakaran office was burnt in Madurai, Melur. So all these things, if you take all these things into consideration, this falls under Section 3 important, I think that period is 77, 78 and period 76. One is fingerprint expert. One will be an expert in the photography, electronic photography. One will be expert in that spot analysis like any electric circuit, a short circuiting of the electric circuit could have caused the fire incident or not. Ultimately, we'll say no. And second one is an electronic evidence when any tampering in the video recording, because all persons who recorded video will go hostile, except Mr. Nakiran Gopal and his colleague, co-editor Mr. Kamraj. Except these two witnesses, all other witnesses will go. But they will say that this is what the record which was sent by my correspondent. My correspondent and videographers both were in the spot, but they will depose before the court. I had a stomachache. I did not go to the spot. I did not record that. They will say that. But Gopalan will disprove it. So Gopalan will say that no. This both were in the spot. They recorded. They sent it. I only published it in the same weekly edition. That's what they sent through the video. That is what has been published in so-and-so magazine of that weekly magazine of that Nakira. So he will prove that same. He will, but for that backing, the expert of the electronic evidence will be there. Electronic evidence. He will opine that it is not a tampered. It is not manipulated. Nothing has been added or nothing has been deleted. This CD is the original CD as such it was recorded. There is no morphing at all. All this expert relevancy, this evidence of the expert will fall under Section 45A of the Evidence Act. This is how this 45 to 50 or 51, I think, up to that, it's all pertaining to the expertness. Expertness, fact bearing the question on expertness and opinion of usage, tenants, opinion of rights, customs, opinion as to signature. 47 opinion as to signature, which is important. 47 has to be compared with 67 and 73. 67 is a proof of signature. 47 is an expert. Once the signature has been sent to the expert and expert comes and deposes with the court, the strokes are same, strokes are different. And this signature is the same as that of the sample. This is a signature that's been placed in the document. Both are similar and same. Sample taken is same and similar to that of the that's in the document for the purpose of proving the forgery. All these things will fall under Section 47 of the Evidence Act. That is relevant. 48 is also that pertaining to some opinion expert as to the right customs, usage, tenants, and relationship, and the grounds on which the opinion is given is also relevant under Section 50 of the Evidence Act, 51 of the Evidence Act. This is how it has to be taken. This is the last portion. For the relevancy is concerned, we have come to the last portion of it. And finally, the character. Character is how relevant. Civil cases, imputing the character is not relevant at all. Throw it out. You say it's a, he's a, imputed person or not imputed person, I don't mind about. We'll see the documents, we'll see the evidence, and we will record the judgment. That's how the civil cases is 52. 53 says good character is relevant in criminal case. 54 says bad character is relevant in the 54 says bad character is relevant in the criminal cases. Bad character is irrelevant, but good character is relevant. Suppose if the accused pleads that I am of a good character, then the prosecution may lead evidence. No, this fellow is a bad character fellow. He was 10 times he has gone to the jail. You can rebut it. The good character could be rebutted. Once a good character is going to be taken as a plea, then the bad character can be taken into plea and it could be taken as a relevant one. Then comes to 55, it's a character affecting the damages. That is connected to the Section 12 of the Evidence Act. Just go through the Section 12 and Section 55. Please compare that pertaining to the damages. What are the things that are relevant? It is a character which is affecting the damages. Suppose I file a defamation. What are the facts which are affecting my reputation? Those things will be taken into consideration. So therefore, the characters which are affecting the damage, calculation of the damage, that's also be taken into consideration. That is relevant under Section 55. This is how Section 5 to 55 are going through in the Evidence Act, passing through in the Evidence Act. Only these things are relevant. Except these things, all other things are irrelevant. It has to be stated to admit a thing in the court. It has to be stated it is relevant under Section 55 of the Evidence Act. This is how the relevancy has been explained. Now we'll go to the next chapter, that's facts which need not be proved. For the facts which need not be proved, it should be judicially noticeable fact or a fact which is admitted. The fact is, if it is admitted, it is called the admitted fact. That need not be proved. If it is a judicially noticeable fact, then it need not be proved. For this also, you can take two judgments. Judicially noticeable fact, you can say, same Attack Mandi case, you can take I quote, Amla I quote, and another one is Ramraj case, which I already explained. That is also judicially this in which judicially noticeable power under Section 56 and 57 both were used. How it was used, I'll give a small narration about it. In Ramraj case, the rifle will be thrown in the Kuvam River, that part, it's a part of the Kuvam River where it's very close to the Napier Bridge, where the Bay of Bengal will merge with the Kuvam River. Often there will be a back water and the back current will be there and it will be very difficult to swim at all. And the prosecution will engage the fire brigades and fire personnels, fire department personnels, for the purpose of swimming into this current. And they will dig out all these small cartridges which were not used and other things. And for the purpose of going to the very close to that sea, and for digging this one, the swimmers were used. The fishermen who are efficient in swimming, sea swimming, they were used and picked up recovered all this small microbe, pullets and other unused cartridges and packets and all. The defense will raise a plea that why the firemen were not used, the private people were used. So therefore, it creates a doubt on the case of the prosecution. That's what the plea that's been raised before the court. Ultimately, court will say, we can take a judicial notice of it. That's a place with a very high current. The fire personnel will not be having that much of competency and efficiency to swim in this current. Only the fishermen alone can swim into the current. Therefore, your defense is overruled. It cannot be accepted. This was struck down. This was negative. The argument was negative. This is how the judicial notice had been taken. Then the second Attack Pandi case, it was published in the thing which has happened, and Attack Pandi and his lieutenants came there and they had a mess. They created a mess coming with a white bottle, having some liquid in that, pouring in all vehicles and setting fire and all. It's been noticed in all videos, putting it in the all medias and other things. The court said we can take a judicial notice. Apart from that, court is having power under Section 3 of the Evidence Act. See the proof. After considering the matter before it, it is not evidence. After considering the matter before it, matter is a part of the evidence. That's it. We can go beyond the evidence also. And we can go beyond the evidence. The matter and judicial, we have the power to take note of certain things, judicially notice it, and we have the power under section 56 and 57 of the Evidence Act for the purpose of taking a judicial notice. So this is how it has to be explained. Judicial notice and the fact admitted may not be proved. So for judicial notice, I have given two examples. One is Attack Mandi's case, another one is Ramraj case. These two cases you can go through for the purpose. It is a beautifully written cases where Banu case and the connected Banu's connected Dina's case are all very well written, beautifully written case for purpose of understanding certain provisions of the Evidence Act. Please go through that repeatedly for understanding it. Then comes the oral evidence and document evidence. As already I narrated the oral evidence when I took section 3 of the Evidence Act. Oral evidence, all facts could be proved by oral evidence. All facts, every facts could be proved by oral evidence except the contents of the document evidence and the contents of the electronic records. Otherwise, except these two contents, all other things could be proved by oral evidence. Provided oral evidence must be direct. 60 mandates that oral evidence must be direct. It should be direct except section, part of the same transaction under section 6 of the Evidence Act and 32 of the Evidence Act, which is the dying declaration of the person died. These are the two things exemption for the directness. It could be indirect. I can hear it. The person who dies, he says that I was stabbed by A. I can hear it. I can go and depose before the court. He said, so it becomes the exemption has been given for hearsay. Somebody can also say that by he deposed, he said that he says to Mr. So and so that he was stabbed by so and so. So that is also admissible because the hearsay is exempted under this 60. The 60 exempts the part of the same transaction. It is a part of the same transaction. It falls under the part of the same transaction. And also will fall under section 32 also. So therefore, you have to compare the 3 and 59 and 60 and 6 and 32. That's an exemption to that. And also you have to see 91 and 92. Because 91 and 92 says the terms of the contract has to be proved only by means of that contract deed. No oral evidence could be permitted for the purpose of contradicting the any terms that's been declared in the contract, grant or disposition of the property. So all these 3, 5960, 3, 5960, then 6 and 32, then for purpose of 5960, you have to compare it with 90 or 91 and 92 also. Please, this is for the purpose of better understanding and saying. If you see the section alone, you might not retain in your mind. When you have a comparison of the charts, it will very stick on with your mind very comfortably. So therefore, I am saying this. So we are in, I did not move this. Oral evidence must be direct. Here you see, if it refers to the fact which has been heard, I heard something. I should go and say that I heard. Mr. X should not go and say Mr. Balaji heard. It's hit by hearsay. But I would have said to him also, sir, I heard this, sir, to the X I could have said, I heard this, this was the sound I heard. If X goes and says before the court, it becomes hearsay. If I go and say before the court, it's not hearsay. So if it refers to perceived by other senses in the manner, it must be the evidence of the person who says that he perceived it. I saw it, I sensed it, I felt it, I tasted it, something like that. So I perceived it. So by means of this sensor in that manner, by that sensor in that manner. So this is how it, if I see that, I should go and say I saw that. If I heard that, I should go and see I have heard that. So this is how the directness is being defined here. This evidence is oral evidence must be direct, except section 6 and section 32 of the Evidence Act, which gives an exemption for this direct evidence. So as per the oral evidence, all facts could be proved by means of, see here, all facts, except the contents of the documents and original records may be proved by oral evidence. This is so important. Except that's therefore, there's a different mode of proof. for the purpose of documents and electronic evidence alone. I think we can continue some other day next week, sir. Madam, Adilshmi, madam.
Yes, sir. I think she has.
Is that time is up or my energy is
not up? Up to 12 o'clock, sir. Up to 12 o'clock, maybe we can have a.
Sir.
Okay.
Sir. You can go till 12:30, sir. No issues. If the participants are willing, I'll ask the participants. Participants, can you stay back till 12:30? Please post it in the chat box. Is the chat box open, volunteer?
I'll also open
chat box.
Meanwhile, I'll take some
breaks. Yes. Sir, நீங்க ஒரு 5 minutes break எடுத்துட்டு வாங்க. வீடியோ ஆஃப் பண்ணிக்கோங்க. Everybody are ready to stay till 12:30, sir. You can go till 12:30, sir. 12:25 க்கு நம்ம முடிச்சுக்கலாம். 12:30 வரைக்கும் ஷெட்யூல் இருக்கு.
Okay, 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 okay.
Okay, you can go till 12:30, sir.
Okay, I'll go proceed. Okay. Am I fast or my words are understandable or?
Sir, it's correct, sir.
Okay.
It's correct. You have to finish. Exams are coming. No, sir. It's correct.
Understand. I am.
Yes, sir. You're clear, sir. Very nice. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Then we'll come. I'll give a rather giving a detail. If I go detail and go deep, because what it's coming emitting out continuously, you will not be able to. My purpose is that whatever I say, it should get into your mind. That's what I feel like. This is how the oral evidence must be direct. That's been defined in the section 59 and 60. We'll come to the documentary evidence now. Documentary evidence, what's the mandate that's been created is, as far as the documentary evidence is concerned, proof of documents. If you take a document, for simple understanding, I'll say the document could be comprised about 4 or 5 parts. How? The document is like almost like a contract or an agreement. Agreement plus legal enforceability is a contract. Say it's a simple definition as such. So there must be some two parties must be there agreeing some terms and conditions. I'll give this in consideration in quid pro quo. You give this to me. This is how the parties, there will be some two parties will be there. The parties will sign the document. The contents will be there. The parties, what they agreed upon, what is less agreed upon, what is more agreed upon will be the mode of contention before the court. This is what this not been agreed upon, but he is taking a wrong claim. It's a more, it's not agreed upon, he is taking a more demand. Some contract will define certain terms. This document will define certain terms. So therefore, proof must be for party. It has been executed between him and the two persons, A and B. Number two, the contents of the document. What are the contents of the document? And third one is who signed the document and executed the document? Who are all the persons who are signatory and party to the contents of the document? And the fourth one is the important one. Who are the person who are attesting the document? Present days, now 4 ingredients are there important to be proved before the court. Earlier, before that, there will be a scribe used to write the documents. These parties came and so-and-so, this deed is executed for this Tanadi Vinaya Vikramath Yokyamai, Buthira Bhatiramilka Bhakyamai, sale deed. இந்த வில்லங்கம் இல்லாமல் நான் இந்த பத்திரத்தை உங்களுக்கு இந்த இடத்தை விட்டு விடுகிறேன், இதை பொறுத்து எந்த விதமான வில்லங்கம் வந்தாலும் அப்படின்லாம் எழுது. அந்த ட்ரெடிஷ்னல் ரைட்டர்ஸ், தே ஆர் கால் ஸ்கிரைப்ஸ். இப்போ அந்த ஸ்கிரைப்ஸ் அதுக்கு இம்பார்ட்டன்ஸ் இல்லை, பட் இம்பார்ட்டன்ஸ் இஸ் ஹூ ஆர் ஆர் த பார்ட்டிஸ், ஹூ ஆர் ஆர் த எக்ஸிக்யூட்டன்ஸ், ஹூ ஆர் வாட் ஆர் த கண்டென்ட்ஸ். ஸோ ஹியர் 61 ஹியர் சேஸ் கண்டென்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் த டாக்குமெண்ட்ஸ் மஸ்ட் பி ப்ரூவ்ட் ஐதர் பை தி பிரைமரி டாக்குமெண்ட்ஸ் or very secondary document. Primary or secondary must be the important one. What is primary? primary means the document itself is produced before for the inspection of the court. That's what we saw in the section 3 also. Section 3 we saw what are all documents, any substance on which any matter. Substance is a cloth, it may be a stone, it may be a paper, or it may be a leather, earlier those days leather. Any substance on which any matter is described or ascribed by means of the letter figure marks. By means of letter figure marks, even if you put a dot and comma in a piece of paper, it will become a document. So document, the paper is a substance, and the comma and the full stop are the matters. So you know the contents are the comma and the full stop are the content. If I sign in the document, I am the party to the document, I am the executant of the document. If I attest the document, so such and such person has signed in the document. The attestor need not be knowing that contents. He may not have the party to the contents. He may not have, would not have agreed upon or he would have had a consensus for the contents. Contents is only between the consensus between the contents or the consensus between the parties alone. We cannot travel beyond the parties. But attestor, who are all the attestors? Attestors who says that Mr. A has signed, Mr. B has signed. This is that's it. Attestor's duty is this was the two persons who have signed the documents. So therefore, first the evidence act is just taken for the purpose of the proof, for the purpose of proof, the contents of the document. What are the contents? How the contents could be proved? The contents could be proved by means of the primary document. Document itself when it's produced, that is 62. Then 63 says secondary. What are the secondary documents? Secondary documents are certificate copies, sale deed certificate copies. You can take a certificate copies of sale deed. Copies made from the original by means of the mechanical process. Copies made by comparing originals. Earlier days, there will be a writer sitting outside the sub-registrar's office. Once you make a copy of application, they will exactly write what is in the original document. They will take the record and they will exactly write what is written in that. And they will certify it with the correction and all will be authenticated and it will be signed, countersigned, and they will give us certificate copies. So these are the copies which are compared with the original, the copies have been made. And counterparts of these certain documents. Then other oral accounts of contents of the document given by some persons who has himself has seen it. So these are all the secondary definitions for the secondary documents are given. We'll for better understanding, we'll take copies made from the original, certified copies, and copies compared with the original. We can, for the better understanding, we can take. Keep it in your mind, 63 and 65, both are dealing with the secondary documents. 62 and 64 deals with the primary documents. What 62 says is the document itself is produced before the court of law. That is called the primary document. Then 63, I have said, secondary document. Made from the original, copies made from the mechanical process or original, even Xerox copies are all coming under the 63. Then 64, it mandates document must be proved by the primary evidence except herein after exempted, except herein after mentioned. So what is the mandate that's been declared by the, given by the Evidence Act? The document must be proved by means of the primary evidence. In certain those cases, in the secondary evidence also could be given, but it should satisfy, you should satisfy the section 65 of the Evidence Act. That's what the 65 says. 65 says what? When the original is in the power and possession of the other person, appears to be in the possession and power of the person against whom the litigation is conducted, against whom the document is sought to be proved, litigation is conducted or sought to be proved, any person out of reach. The document is not in my possession, you have to prove. Then second, when the existence and conditions of the contents of the original have been proved to be admitted in writing, that the person against whom it is proved is then the representative interest. This is a B. The existence and contents, condition or contents of the original have been proved to be admitted in writing. Admitted in writing, he admits in writing by the person against whom it is proved or is representative in interest. I'll consider, I'll go through that, but I don't understand the phraseology of it. I'll just go through that. When the original has been destroyed or lost, then you can produce a second evidence of it. When a party offering the evidence of its contents cannot, and of any other reason arising from his own default or neglect, could not produce the produce in the reasonable time. That's a simple understanding is that it's been destroyed. When the original is of such a nature, it is not movable. Example is, in those days, the computers will be of huge, big servers will be there for each computers, which cannot be moved at all. So those computers, if you take a printout of it, it becomes a secondary document. What are the original contents in the server? Those contents of that will be the secondary documents. Originals are the public documents. Some documents which are retained in, compared with the original. The original will be the primary document, and the copied made out of it will be the compared, copied made out of will be the secondary document. These are all the factors. These are all the 7 or 8 illustrations where you can give lead a secondary evidence. Then further it says cannot be movable. Original of the public document within the meaning of section 74. Original. What is original? That's a public document which is falling under section 74. If you compare the original and take a printout of it, that will fall under section 63 and 65. That is the secondary document. And the original that is retained in the public office will be the 74. Will be the 74 document. That is a public document. And the original of the document of which the certificate copy is permitted by the Act, which I already explained. Then when the original consists of numerous accounts and the documents which cannot be conveniently examined by the court, it's similar to that of the easily more, not easily movable, not to be easily movable. It's because it's a very voluminous thing which cannot be examined by the court, and the fact to be proved is a general result of the those collections. So this is a simple thing that it cannot be moved. It's a voluminous thing which cannot be perused by the court. These are the conditions which permits the court to lead evidence through the secondary evidence, secondary documents. These are the things. So now you understood. Under section 61, it says that document should be proved by the primary document and secondary document. And the 62 says the document, when the document itself has been produced before the court of law, it is a primary document. 64 says the contents of the document should be proved by primary document alone, except in the cases of the secondary, except in the cases in the 65, herein after mentioned, that is 65. 63 says any document which is made in the mechanical process, copies of the mechanical process, Xerox copies, any documents made from the copies of the originals, all other things, these things are secondary documents. So secondary documents, when it could be proved by the court, by the party, like that of the instances which have been said in the 65. I don't possess the original. Original is in the person against whom I'm conducting the litigation, against whom it is sought to be proved. Not movable, cannot be moved from the one place to another. It's in the huge server, like a computer server, which cannot be moved. And a huge voluminous accounts, which cannot be produced before the court of law, cannot be produced, perused. So all these things are stated in the 65. This is how the documents in general, contents of the documents are proved, apart from the 65. We will come to 65A and B little later. Apart from the 65A and B, if you could go to 66, if you are falling under section 65, you have to produce a notice. See, I don't have the document, you are in the possession of the document, you produce the document. This is, unless otherwise you produce a notice of it, rules for us to produce a notice, you will not be entitled to make use of this 65 documents, secondary documents. So therefore, the mandate has been given. You have to take all the efforts for the purpose of, before seeking getting into 65, you have to prove that the document has been lost. This document has been lost, the FIR has been registered, and it could not be traceable. This is an untraceable certificate I have. These are the things which you have to prove in order to make you to entitle to come under the 65 of Evidence Act, 65 of the Evidence Act. So as to entitle you to lead evidence on the basis of the secondary evidence. Then comes the proof of signature. I said already said the parties will be signing in that, and the proof of signature will be signed, will be here signed, is purported to have been signed by him. It has to prove that it has been purported to have been signed by him. For this purpose, you can make use of the expert evidence under section 47. And also for this purpose, you can also go to section 73 of the Evidence Act. 73 of the Evidence Act is a power of the judge gives 73 gives power to the judge to compare the signature of the sample with the original, whether this signature could have been made by this person or not. This such as a wide power has been given under section 73. Apart from 73, if the judges, apart from the 73, section 47 gives the power to the expert opinion to compare the signature, handwritings and seals, and to compare it with the originals and samples to say that it's been purported to be signed by the same person. So this is a proof of the signature. Any document will have a signature. So for the purpose of this proving the document, begin just below the 65, the 67 is also added. And this is how this, it has to be read with. Then 67 digital signature, nowadays the digital signature has come. So this could be compared, and digital for this certain for filing income tax returns, we use the digital signature. I never use. My auditor sent something. I have only click on the link. Sir, you just click the link in the email. That's it. We will produce you will have a digital signature. So this is how it's been made. It's all this new development that has come. Now we have come to e-file, and all the scanned documents signed by the advocate are all going to the court. And this is how the way of life of changed because of this electronic world. Okay. Then after the 67, except the case, I'll also just read the digital signature of any subscriber alleged to have been affixed to the electronic record. Even the judgments are now signed electronically by the judges. If you take the judgments or orders, daily orders of the Supreme Court, there'll be a bottom small note will be there saying that it's electronically signed. Once you download it from the internet, from the official website of the Supreme Court, it will say that it's electronically signed, digitally signed. So it could be used as an authenticated copy of the order, authenticated copy of the court order. This is how this section 67 is mandated for the purpose of extension to the 67. Now, we'll go to 68 now. 68 is execution, proof of execution. I said already there were four important parts, party, then contents, then execution, then attestation. Here comes the execution part. Who has executed and who has attested, whether the attesting witness now comes and deposes before the court that it's been executed by so-and-so. So you see, understand that the executant is who has signed the, as a party who has signed the document. Attestation is a person who says that this person has signed. That's it. So here, 68, 69, 70, 71, and 72, all the five sections says and describes about how the execution has to be proved before the court of law. Execution. If the document is required by the law to be attested, at least two witnesses has to be it shall not be used as an evidence until at least one. One attesting witness at least has been called for the purpose of proving it. At least one attesting witness to come and say that this document has been signed by this person. One attesting witness has to come and say. If it is going to be a registered document, it is not a proviso says if it is going to be a registered document. If it is a registered document, it is not required. Unless it is a will. For a will, at least one, this mandate again comes in case of will, again, you go back to the main provision. At least one person should come and say, this will was signed by this person. This is a will of this person. I know the signature of this person who has executed this will. Testator. So in case of will, it is very useful. Section 65. In case the attesting witness is not formed, when the attesting witness is not formed, the attester who attested in the document that such A has signed in the document, he is not formed. Witness number one, witness number two is not formed. Then somebody has to be brought who knows the signature of this executant and attested as well. But then you just see this. If it is not formed and if the document purpose to have been executed in the United Kingdom, it must be proved that the attestation of one of the attesting witness at least is in the handwriting and the signature of the person who is executing the document is in his signature and handwriting. So, the person who has signed in the document as a party A, his signature must be known to the person here who is coming and deposing before the court. And also he must be knowing the signature of the one of the attesting witness who attested in the document. This is how it has to be proved. That even the attesting witness is not formed. then we have to rely upon the third party. That's it. But the third party, what is the condition and mandate? The third party must know that signature and handwriting of the person who is executing the document and the person who is attesting the document. One of the person who is attesting, not required to both the persons. At least one of the person who is attesting the document. This is how this section 69 says. What is section 70? 70 says if the admission has been made by the party to the document, yes, 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 this was executed by me. That is sufficient evidence. That's what it says. 70. 70, you say, if you go through the section 70, admission of a party to the attested document of its execution by himself shall be the sufficient proof of the execution against himself. If he says that I executed the document, that is, if it amounts to an admission, that itself is a sufficient evidence to for the purpose of proving the document, execution of the document. Contents is different. Here we are in the execution. Suppose if it is denied by the attesting witness. Proof, when the proof, how to prove it? When the attesting witness denies the execution. Attesting witness is saying, no, I don't have the memory. It was very long back. I don't remember that, loss of memory. Or he says that, no, I did not sign in the as an attesting witness. Then it has to be proved by some other means and some other way. Some other like that of somebody who knows the signature of this man, somebody who knows the signature of the executant, somebody who knows the signature of the attesting witness. All these things are some other way you have to prove it, prove the execution. The attesting witness denies or does not recollect the execution of the document, its execution may be proved by other evidences. That's in a normal manner, you can, subject to the other provisions of law, you have to prove it, prove the execution of the document. If the same thing like 71, 72 says, if the proof of the document which is not required to be attested, it says that attestation itself is not required, simply the party signature is required, that's it. If that is the case, it also can be proved in the other way. So need not bring the attesting witness and other things are not at all required. You can prove it as it is an unattested document. It can be proved as if it is an unattested document. This is a 72 of the Evidence Act says. 73 already I said, it's compared to section 67 of the Evidence Act, the signature, proving the signature, proving the handwriting, proving the seal. And so when 67, for the purpose of 67, you can also, the court is also empowered with section 73 to compare the signature with the handwriting, seal and other signatures. Comparison of signature, writing, seal, other writing and all. So you have a very wide power for the court to, it's also one of the important power. If you take the consideration of the power of the court falls from section 3, power of the court section 5, power of the court section 114, power of the court under 4, presume, court may presume, shall presume conclusive proof. Court will have a power under section 73 to compare the signature. Court is having a power under section 136 of the Evidence Act to decide the admissibility of the fact and issue under relevant fact. Then it is having a power under section 148 when the witness is compelled to answer and not compelled to answer, and he can warn the witness that you are not compelled to answer. You, apart from the 148, they have the power under section 150 to send a report as to the unreasonable questions that's been asked to the witnesses to the High Court. That is under section 150, they have the power, court is having power. Under section 165, the court is having a very enormous power to put a question to the, it's a court is not, the judge is not a presiding officer, is not a secretary. He can interact with the witness at any time, any form, any question can be placed for the purpose of finding out the truth of the issue, for the purpose of finding out the truth. This question can be relevant, this question can be irrelevant. The other party cannot object it. We have to keep silent. Either the defense or the prosecution, they have to keep silent. Such a very wide power has been used under section 165 of the Evidence Act. These are all the 4, 5, 6 sections you have to go through in the Evidence Act for the purpose of your examination. This one among the sections is 73 to compare the signature. 74, public document, all the documents which are maintained in the public office.
Sir?
Yes, madam.
Yes, can you go further or you want a break? We'll continue next time, sir. You feel tired. Participants chat box la potrukanga. Adnala da I just intervened.
Illa endha oralukku mudichikalam oralukku pom.
Ungalku onna prachana illa illaya sir.
Inno oru section nama eduthu da aagum nenikiren because we have very important.
Ama sir, innonu edukano.
competency of the witnesses, chief and cross is there important. இதுக்கப்புறம்
ஓகே இப்ப எந்த செக்ஷன் வரைக்கும் உங்களால போக முடியுமோ அது வரைக்கும் போகணும்.
That I will try man. I can go up to 100 I think that it's the other things are very simple where we can just we have a glance of it and I can just give it. Then
okay, we'll have
yes, section 1 1 1.
Sorry to interrupt sir. Sorry to interrupt. You can start from public documents sir. Thank you sir. Thank you.
Public documents are the documents which are maintained in the sovereign authority, official bodies and tribunal, or simple to understand, yourself can read and understand all these things. And our public officers like any revenue officer or any sub-registrar officers and legislative, executive, judicial are part of India and Commonwealth or foreign country. Public records kept for the purpose of the private document. Suppose I am registering a sale deed. It's a private document, like my right title interest is transferred to somebody else, to X. But that register that is kept in the public records, that becomes a public document under Section 74. So the certificate copy could be obtained. All other documents are private documents, except the documents which are provided under Section 74 of the Evidence Act. All other documents could be termed as the private documents. This is what the all other documents, Section 75 says. All other documents are the private documents. 74 is a public document, sovereign authority. The documents forming part of the Act or forming Act of the records of the Act of the sovereign activity, sovereign authority, official body and tribunal, public officer, legislative, judicial, public officers, legislative, judicial and executive of the Commonwealth or even the foreign countries. All are public documents, and except what are all stated in the public documents, all other documents are private documents. So certificate, then comes the certificate copies of the public documents, as that of what I discussed already there in 63 and 65. This is certificate copies of the document. And 77, is a proof of the document producing the certificate copy. As far as the public document is concerned, you can prove it by means of the certificate copy, because 77 has to be read along with the 79. 79 says that's a presumption for the public documents. 79, if you take, that's a presumption for the documents. Presumption from 79 to 90A, that is a presumption. That's presumptions pertaining to various documents. Here, the genuineness of the certificate. See here, 79 comes. 79, by producing the certificate copy of the public document, the court shall presume that it is genuine. The genuineness of the certificate copy of the public document. It is so important. Just you can, that 79 to 90 will come again, because two important sections we have just jumped over or skipped over, that is 65A and 65B. It's a great task nowadays as to the admissibility and the appreciation of the evidence of the electronic records, which I'll just give a glimpse of it. And up to this, you just go through that. And this presumption as to 70 to 90 and oral evidence and exclusion of the oral evidence and document evidence, we will include in the next session, because that electronic evidence itself requires a detailed consultation, because it's a requirement of this current situations and days. The scenario is, we are living in the electronic media. We are living in the, what you called cyber media. And therefore, so important, you may anticipate some questions on the basis of this 65A and 65B. I'll narrate some of 3 or 4 cases for it, for the simple understanding. I'll just, 65A says, see, special provisions, just they are introducing the special provisions for the purpose of electronic evidence, introduced in the year 2000. 65B speaks of the admissibility of the electronic evidence. 65A simply speaks of the special provisions. So what is electronic evidence is fundamental question. What would be termed as electronic evidence? So here, if you see, we'll go based on the section, we'll be seeing. See, notwithstanding anything contained in this act, in this evidence act, any information contained in the electronic record. So they simply say, like that of a document, which is a record, any information which is containing in the electronic record. Electronic record is that information. I have drafted a plaint here. This plaint is in my computer. There is an information in the, that is a whole plaint. If you take that whole plaint is the electronic record. In that electronic record, I put a small cause title, I put a long cause title, then I put the this how this document came in, how this property came in the possession of this plaintiff. He was enjoying the property. He acquired the right title interest of the property from his ancestor or partition or sale deed or what. And there is a cause of action. There is a stamp duty that is to pay. And there is a relief that has been granted. All these are pieces of information in the electronic record. If all these informations are clubbed together, and if you put an output for it, output, how the output comes, output may be by means of a printout. That's a printout may come from the, if I have drafted my plaint in my own computer, it's not from some other computer. Suppose if I get it from some other computer, if it comes to my computer is not the author of that, creator of that document, electronic record. My computer is only holding that and picturizing or exhibiting that. That's it. But which computer has created it? So from that computer, I take a printout. How the printout, it could be taken as a printout. You see this, it could be taken as a printout. Paper as a paper printout, it could be stored or copied in the optical media or electronic media produced by the computer. Then you say one is by means of the paper, one is by means of the optical media, maybe a CD drive, maybe an external hard drive, maybe a pen drive, and one is by means of the magnetic media. So optical media and magnetic media are almost same. So if it is magnetic media, transfer to another computer also. I can put it in a USB cable. I can transfer it to my laptop also. Same document, I can transfer it to some laptop. So these are the three ways that's been explained in the section 65B. One is a printout from the original. There is a printout output is termed as a printout or optical media or magnetic media. If this paper, optical media or magnetic media are shall be deemed to be a document. What is document? We'll have to go to section 3 of the Evidence Act. Document is anything which is produced for the inspection of the court. That is a primary document. Document itself is produced, that is a primary document. It shall be deemed to be a document if the condition mentioned herein or hereinafter are satisfied. The condition, what is the condition? It should have a certificate. That's what everyone says nowadays. They can understand electronic media, 65B certificate, 65B certificate. We can often hear in the court that 65B certificate. 65B certificate is absent. Even in Banu's case, she was acquitted only in the absence of, because of this lack of this 65B certificate. If the 65B certificate was available, then certainly she would have been convicted, because there were a lot of calls transferred between A1 and A2. A2 gave 50,000 rupees to 59. Sorry, 79, PW 79, who is an approver with this. And before the execution of the murder and after the execution of the murder, there were lot of calls to mobile calls to calls, mobile to mobile calls, which were in the logbook, which were in the mobile log CDR that is collected. That's called call detailed record, CDR. It is called a CDR. What is a conduct? It's a previous conduct. It falls under section 8 of the Evidence Act. It's a previous conduct and subsequent conduct about the anxiousness of the A1 pertaining to the incident, whether incident has been properly executed or not. That's how the presumption. You have very wide power for the court under section 114 of the Evidence Act to presume out of this call details. It was not earlier days like this. 10 calls were there just before the incident. Suppose incident happens for by about 8 o'clock. Between 7:40 to 8 o'clock, there will be about 10 calls or 15 calls. After 8 o'clock to 8:30, there will be 15 or 20 calls. If this be the nature of the transaction, call transaction that's happened between A1 and A2, for the court to come to the conclusion that A1 is also guilty of the conspiracy, that this incident and commission of the crime has happened with the blessings of the A1. Certainly. That's why the section 8, you will have to go to see that previous subsequent conduct and motive has been defined there. It's been explained there in the judgment. And why I'm saying this, it's that 65B, as because the 65B certificate has not been obtained from ISP providers, that is the internet providers or the providers of this the telephone network provider, this therefore, this because of the absence of the 65B certificate, this evidence was the CDR record, the call detail records were not considered by the court, and this evidence were eschewed from the consultation, from being consultation. Therefore, it became the situation that sufficient materials were not available as against the A1. Therefore, the A1 got acquitted. A1 is nothing, the own sister-in-law of the deceased, that is, the wife of the deceased and the A1, both are sisters. As because the sister was enjoying the properties of Mrs. Janaki Ramachandran and MGR, she had a grudge over the but the deceased. She is managing all the affairs, therefore it has to be done away with. This is what the story of the case says. So this 65B, I'm saying about the 65B certificate. So if the conditions of this 65B certificate are satisfied, the document, the secondary document, output is what? Output is a secondary document because it's taken out from the original. Suppose my own computer itself is going to be produced before the court. My computer, I'm taking this computer because the earlier days the computers were very huge. Nowadays it's including, my computer is now including CPU and all. It's all in all desktop. I say that all in all desktop, something like that. So this includes the CPU. This includes the C drive. This includes other, this motherboard, everything is there. Just like a big laptop it is. Keypad alone is out. If I produce the entire computer there in the court, see, this is what the document I have, this is what the computer which produced. Is it the primary evidence? It is a primary evidence. Why? Because this has created it. The document has not come from anywhere else. This computer is the creator of the document. Therefore, this document is a primary evidence because it's coming, it is seen on giving the electricity, on giving the proper motherboard and other technical aspects. This is exhibited in the bimbam. Bimbam means in a virtual image. Namak theriyudhu adu vandu simple ah nam tamil la solrumna bimbama theriyudhu. Power card pudingi uttan diriyin power poiduchu. This suddenly that electricity goes out, power switched off, then it will hide. It will go off, so it will not be visible. So it will be visible on the electronic media. So when the original, this original computer itself is produced, that computer becomes the primary evidence. And if the output is produced like that of the, in a small piece of paper, like a printout, this printout, or in the pen drive, or in the CD drive. So all these things will become a pen drive. All these things, if I take a copy of this client in this pen drive, that becomes an output. That output is nothing but secondary evidence. If you are going to produce this secondary evidence before the court of law, it requires the certificate. It's nothing more than that. I so-and-so Balaji, I so-and-so, I certify that this computer from which this document was created or stored, copied, record, processed on day-to-day affairs, on day-to-day basis, which is day-to-day in the day-to-day business, I use it. And from where this copy has been recorded, this copy is a genuine one. It is not manipulated, tampered, or anything has been added or deleted. As such, what is produced in the computer, created by the computer, I'm getting a copy of it and giving it before the court. I'm giving the certificate. This, to the best of my knowledge and belief, this information I provided is true and correct to the best of my knowledge. As that of MENA verification, what verification we used to give in the court, same verification we used to give it in the last one. That's what the bottom of this 3-4 classes. But if you think that it's very complicated, if you understand this is not a complicated section, very easy to understand. So because it's a very lengthy provisions have been given in 65A, 65B, the people used to scare for it. They say, sir, nothing is, we don't understand anything. What is it's copied, transferred, it's nothing else, nothing else. Original computer, what is producing the plane? From out of which I want to take a printout in the media. This is called optical media or magnetic media. We can say both of this. If I take it in the CD, that is one media. If I take it in pen drive, that is another media, magnetic media. If I take it in another computer like a laptop, that is another media. It's an output. From out of the original, an output is given, and the output is called the secondary evidence. If the output added with the certificate, output plus certificate, it is deemed a document, an elevated document. It's an elevated status. It goes to the elevated status of the primary document. So when the primary document, when it is given along with the certificate, the court will consider that as a primary document. That is the status of this 65D. There is nothing more than that. So who is in the possession of the, I am in the lawful possession of the computer. I am using the computer on a day-to-day basis. I am regularly using the computer for the purpose of feeding the data and records. So when that is the case, that is what is expected from the court of law. So I am using it. I have not manipulated or tampered. I have given the original as such. This is the certificate required. If this certificate is required, if certificate is given along with the output, which is otherwise called a secondary evidence, this could be used as the evidence before the court of law. This is how the 65B could be simply explained. Okay? I'll show that this is deemed to be a document if it satisfies the conditions. If the conditions mentioned in the sections are satisfied in relation to the information and computer in question, and shall be admissible in any proceedings without any further proof. No further proof is required. Or production of the original. In our original computer produced, no, not required. No, not required. I'll have to produce. And any contents of the original or any other thing. That's what. Very. No other proof is required. Not without requiring to produce the originals of this computer. What are the conditions? Conditions, the output containing the information which was produced in the day-to-day feeding and all. This is how this goes. Then you come to subsection 4. And in any procedure where it is desired to give a statement in evidence by which of the section, a certificate doing the following things, that is to say, identifying the electronic record containing the statement. I identify the electronic record is my describing the manner in which it was produced. I do it in my day-to-day affairs, day-to-day feeding, day-to-day recording, day-to-day entering of data, and giving such particulars of the device involved in the production of such electronic record as may be appropriate for the purpose of showing that the electronic record was produced by that computer. Most important is this electronic record was produced by this computer. This is important. This we'll have to say in the certificate. And at last we'll have to say here, see this, in the manner best of my knowledge and belief, this shall be the evidence. And purporting to be signed by the persons occupying in the responsible position relation to the operation of the relevant device and management of the relevant device shall be the evidence of the matter stated in the certificate, and for the purpose of this section it shall be sufficient for the maker to be stated to be the best of my knowledge and belief of that person stating it. This is the certificate, nothing more than that. A private person can give a certificate. It is not required. I'll have to take the computer to the IT department, and there will be an officer sitting there, and he will compare it. He will be an expert. Then he has to be called an exam. It's not required. If I am using, I am legally in a position, I am occupying the responsible position in relation to the operation of the device. If I am using it in day-to-day affairs, if I give a certificate, that certificate is enough, but subject to this knowledge and belief, best of my knowledge and belief, I am producing the exact original. This is reproduced in the output. That's it. That is enough. This is what has been dealt in the three important or four important case nowadays, taking into consideration Arjun Pandit. Very recently, that's been declared. Earlier, there were three cases, very important cases, which you'll have to keep in mind. First one is Navjot Sandhu case. Navjot Sandhu case is a case of this parliament attack case where this question was considered. Court said you produce original. One mode is you produce original and prove it, number one. Entire server, entire computer, bring it in the court and produce it. Second one is you get an output. Along with that, come with a certificate for the purpose of admitting that. That's it. The reliability is different. Then it is reliable, sufficient, weightage, that's totally different. But for the purpose of admission, I'm saying, you come with a certificate. If these two things are absent, it will not prevent you from proving it under section 63 and 65 of the Evidence Act. That is secondary evidence. If it is lost, if it is destroyed, if it is in the possession of the others, I'm not able to get the certificate. In the possession of the others, I'm not able to get the certificate from the person who's concerned. How can I get the certificate? I still have an evidence. How can I get a certificate from the other person? It's impossible. So, the Navjot Sandhu's case said there are three modes. You produce the original. No, if you are not producing the original, you produce the original output with a certificate. Third one is you produce the even. If you do not have this, this will not prevent your right from proving the document under section 63 and 65. That's a section, that is the section that has been, I'll just give a, this section is over. I'll give another picture, what do you call that, chart, simple chart, handwritten chart, which I made, which for the purpose of understanding myself, I'm just exhibiting that. I'll just try to. Navjot Sandhu's case, that is in 2005. Is it visible? Document is visible, I think. 2005, 11 SEC 600. Navjot Sandhu Parliament attack case. 60. There are three modes. Even if you lose the primary evidence and deemed primary evidence of the certificate, the secondary evidence with the plus certificate, output certificate, still without certificate, you can prove it by means of 63 and 65. This is what has been overruled in P.V. Anwar case in 2014, 10 SEC 486. This is a P.V. Anwar case, which in which the earlier one was overruled. Which one was overruled? Navjot Sandhu was overruled in P.V. Anwar case. Why? Because in the absence of the certificate, because 65A and 65B are itself is an exclusive code, it says notwithstanding anything contained in this act, therefore 65A and 65B will supersede the Evidence Act. So therefore, it is must and mandate whenever you bring the electronic record, it has to be with 65B certificate. Otherwise, it will not be taken into consideration. That's how in Banu's case, take into consideration the PV Anwar's case, the having no certificate having been produced before the court of law, the court eschewed the CDR records, that's a call detailed records between the A1 and A2 Karna. That A2's name is Karna. They say he's a police constable. He's a police constable working in the police department. He made arrangements of PDM 79, then A3. Okay. So this is the second judgment which has been came into picture, which that mandated. That mandates means what the certificate is, unless otherwise certificate is there, electronic record cannot be admitted, cannot be looked into by the court of law. Then came the Safi Mohammed case. That is in 2018, 2 SEC 807. This case said that little deviated from PV Anwar's case, but if you are in the possession, the person who is producing the electronic record, he is in the possession of the computer, or if he is having access to the person who is in the possession of the computer, he can very well get a certificate and produce a certificate. If he is not in the possession of the computer and the real possessor of the computer, operator of the computer is inaccessible, and it's very difficult for him to get the certificate from him, then the certificate is not at all required for the purpose of admitting the electronic records, and certificate is not required. It was divided into two portions. That is, category number one is, if you are producing the electronic record, you are in the possession of the computer. If you are not in the possession of the computer, you are producing the electronic record, but not in the possession of the computer. If that is the case, then you can say, that the certificate is not at all required. If you are in the possession, you produce the certificate. It will tally with PV Anwar. If you don't have the certificate, you need not have to produce a certificate. We will see that. Then it will tally with the Navjot Sandhu's case. Navjot Sandhu says three modes, that's primary evidence, output with the certificate mode, Third mode would be that secondary evidence, 63 and 65. So this is not now, all these things, now this three, leaving alone this three, subsequent to these three judgments, now judgment came in Arjun Pandit case very recently, about 10 or 15, not 10 or 15, about a month back time, month or 1 month or 40 days time. That judgment tallied with Anwar. They said that Anwar is, PV Anwar is right. And therefore, PV Anwar has been confirmed. The bench of three confirmed, another bench of three confirmed the judgment, saying that PV Anwar is right. And whenever you produce electronic record, the certificate is required. The question of this possession, non-possession now goes. Now it is required, it's a mandate. What is the assigned legal position is that you have to produce the 65B certificate for the purpose of proving the electronic record. This is how the law now mandates. This is a settled law now present. Now we cannot go back to the Navjo Sandhu saying that I am entitled, even if I don't have the certificate, I am entitled under section 63 and 65, that is the secondary evidence, hearing secondary evidence. That right is no more available. Now you have to, as per the Arjun Pandit case, now very recently that's been delivered, you are must and mandate to produce a certificate whenever you are adducing evidence on electronic record. This is how this section goes.